Fluffy Elf. Each different background is compatible with the transformation of Supersymmetry, if you are well-defined specific like that. So here the point is, can you find vector from a four-dimensional matrix such that you can solve this equation? Well, equation with the spinor have this property, not always they can solve. For example, if you ask, can you find a constant spinor on a spinor? You have no such term on the sphere, you can't. And the reason, well, it's too technical to explain, but for the sphere is the fact that the commutator of two covariant derivatives is actually proportional to the curvature. So if you have a covariant becomes a spinor, you apply another covariant derivative, you get zero on one side, you get the curvature on the other side. So the point is that, not in general, the equations for spinor are not necessarily solved on any manifold. Mm. So the question here, if you want to write a supersymmetric Lagrangian for a four-dimensional theory, with any one supersymmetry, is the following. Can you choose background field, the main trick, and the left guy such that you can solve this equation? Well, you have to work a little bit to understand if this can be done. It has been studied, and this particular equation the solution of this particular equation has been classified in the last few years. I will not give you the details, but I will briefly give you the result, just for completeness. If you choose to solve this equation for one spin of one chirality, you discover that, for example, your manifold, if you take its Euclidean, which is what we want to do, must be complex. Otherwise, it must be a complex manifold, otherwise you cannot solve this equation. These kind of things are completely different according to the signature of space-time. So for example, even if it's not relevant for this series of lecture, you want to solve the same equation in Lorentzian signature, again you are constrained, but this time the constraint is different. M must have a null filling vector. So typically, the solution of the differential equation for fermion gives you a constraint on the geometry of the manifold. This first result is due to various people, Gumi Crespo, Pestuccia, Cyber, myself actually, Clara Tomasiello. And the second one, the Lorentzian, is again myself with Cassani and Mattel. Okay, this is just to give you a flavor of the kind of equation that you need to solve. And you can change supergravity, you can change dimension, and every time you get different Lagrangians and different constraints. You can be slightly more general and write an equation that in principle should work in all possible cases if you take a conformal field theory. So if you take a super conformal field theory, what you can do is the following. Now a super conformal field theory has a Lorentz group, which is enhanced to the super conformal group, so it's much bigger. The supersymmetries, as you know, are double. There are supersymmetry and superconformal. Conformal supersymmetry, they are usually called Q and S, and the conformal group usually requires to have extra bosonic asymmetries. The bosonic asymmetries transform in some way your supercharges. So whenever the theory is conformal, you can couple to another type of supergravity, which is conformal supergravity. Again, the form of the previous form depends on the dimension, the number of supersymmetry, and so on, but certainly you are using the specificity tensor, the supersymmetry charge, and also the asymmetry in your theory. So in this gravity, there are fields that are gauging the asymmetry, so you have extra vector fields. And the point is that when you do this, essentially, at a linearized level, what you are doing is to add coupling to the specific sensor, the supercurrent, and the asymmetry current of your theory, plus completion. And the point is that in this kind of supergravity, the variation of the gravitino has a simpler and more universal form. And this can be written always in this term. There is a covariant derivative, there is the asymmetry, the cut from the spinor, and there is a second term here, which depends on the second spinor. So this is a structure which is slightly simpler than this one, because it depends on the matrix, on the asymmetric background fields that are something that you usually want to know how they behave. And the point, the reason why you have to spinors is that the number of supersymmetries are double, so the superconformal theory. So say epsilon plus has to do with the supersymmetry, epsilon minus with the conformal supersymmetry. So you need an equation that depends on the spinor, you need to find the spin of epsilon plus and epsilon minus. But in this case, like enough, if you want to set zero, well, you see immediately that one spinor is easily derived with respect to the other. Take this equation, take a contraction with gamma mu, gamma mu is the unit dimension of space-time, and epsilon minus is gamma mu contracted with this guy. So you can eliminate this and write the equation in the simplest form, which is the following. Let me call this derivative with a capital I on top. So whenever in this lecture you see an A on top of a derivative, it means that it's a covariant derivative with respect to the matrix, but also with respect to the other still under which the fermion is charged. And the equation can be easily written in this form. And this guy should be zero. Now, this equation is simple enough. It depends only on the sino, and it's also an equation that is well known also to mathematicians. It's called the conformal Killing equation. Why it's called the conformal Killing equation? Because it's invariant under conformal transformation. And it should be because my starting point was a superconformal field theory. So this equation is somehow simpler than this one. It needs all the story about a figure field. It essentially is somehow more universal because all solutions of this kind of transformation are also solutions of this. The reason is the following. Actually, as well known by supergravity people, most of the Poincaré supergravity has been constructed. The efficient way of constructing supergravity is the following. First, you gauge the superconformal group, so you get something much bigger than what you want, and then you freeze the superconformal group to the Poincaré transformation just by fixing. Typically, you add some scale, some vector multiple, and three superconformal invariants. So most of the Poincaré theory can be obtained going through this step. You first go here, and then go back by gauge fixing. This means that you can check the previous for this equation, the whole solution of this equation is also a solution. So essentially, the guy that I put in the box there is an equation that should be satisfied by the schema on your manifold in order to have supersymmetry. Again, I'm cheating a little bit because if you increase the distance, if you change dimension, if you increase the number of supersymmetry, you typically have other schemas in the theory. You have decide the Garugino, you have other guys, the Garugino, and so on. So you have to put extra constraints. But that equation will be always there. So let me take this and give you a few examples where you can have supersymmetry. I'll give you three of them, and then in the second lecture we will discuss in detail one of them. And possibility, the first obvious possibility is the following. I need to find a manifold where I have a schema to solve this equation. So here is a covariant derivative. Here is a covariant derivative multiplied by gamma matrices. Obvious possibility is, suppose that you have a manifold with a covariantly constant schema. So a schema that are annihilated by the covariant derivative, which may include some extra fields, like for example, a background for the affinity. This is a covariantly constant field, and it essentially defines what in the literature is called a topological field theory. The original example by Witten. The question is, how can I find manifold where there are covariantly constant spino? I told you before that if you just take a sphere, you just set of the EU, you set the EU equal to zero, there is no covariantly constant spino on the sphere. So the sphere is excluded, it's not in this case. If you set A to zero. However, if you write explicitly this expression, clearly this expression is as schematic as the form. So this is the form of your equation. Now the topological twist work in this way. If you are able to cancel these two terms altogether and reduce your equation to the simplest one, you can solve this by taking epsilon constant. And when can you do this trick? Well, essentially, if you see the spin connection as a gauge field for with Hermitian Euclidean now for the local Lorentz tangent group SOD. And the asymmetry is from group G. Well, the point is that these two groups should look together in such a way that you can embed G in SOD and cancel this term. And this can be done in various cases. For example, the original one is back to 88, is the origin of the topological field theory. We can show that if you take any Euclidean form manifold, and you have a theory which has at least n equal to root theory, you can always find a covariantly constant spin and define supersymmetry in this way. This is called the topological twist. And the reason why it works is very simple. In four dimensions, the group is, the function group is a football which is also a Shizu times a Shizu, and the Shino Sari representation of this tangent group, and if you take a Shino which transforms in the representation the representation of Shino 1 up of the first Shizu and the representation 0 of the second one, and this is just a bi-Shino in 4D, so if you try to solve this equation for a particular size Shino, since the Shino is leading only in the representation of Shizu, this spin connection is actually restricted to the subgroup Shizu of Shizu. So it's actually acting on the bi Shino, the spin connection is just in Shizu, and then luckily enough, the asymmetry of any two theory for the nation contains an Shizu factor. So whatever is your spin connection, whatever is the gauge field that you get as a spin connection for your medical, it always turns on an equal gauge field in the asymmetry in such a way that these two guys cancel. So you discover that if you have enough supersymmetry for the nation, you can define a supersymmetric theory with this trick. This is the topological trick. Another obvious case where this works is two dimensions. These are indeed the cases where the topological field theory has been discussed more. In two dimensions, oh sorry, this was last year equal 4, I put it M4. In two dimensions, if you have a Riemann surface, the tangent group is very simple because the tangent group is SU2, which is U1. And if you have a theory with an asymmetry, which is at least U1, for example, if you have a 2,2 supersymmetry, you have an asymmetry which is U1, but you can clearly identify any spin connection with a particular background of the asymmetry. So again, in two dimensions, you can always perform a topological trick. As I told you at the beginning of the lecture, these two cases have been studied in the case in the last almost 30 years. They are very useful. Topological trick theory are useful for geometrical questions. Essentially, the path integral computes the vacuum expectation value observable, computes invariance of the manifold, Donaldson invariance in four dimensions, and the case in the sigma model in two dimensions, you get invariance of the target space. If it is a Calabi-Yau, you get Gromov-Witten invariance. So this is the first case that has been discussed in the literature. Then, let's have a look through the other deposit, in a sense, situation where you have spheres. Spheres have become popular recently, more recently. And for spheres, you can do the following. There's another simple way of solving this equation. And it works even if you have no background for the asymmetry. So suppose that I set the A equal to 0, I just keep it on the Euclidean boundary. And it's easy, I did it as an exercise for you, to check that if you can solve this equation, which is simpler than the one that I wrote, this is called the Killing Spino equation, then you solve also the more general one. Just a stupid exercise you plug in, and you discover that also the conformal Killing equation is satisfied. Well, luckily enough, Killing Spino exists, for example, on all spheres. Also, they exist on essentially on Fibonacci Einstein manifold. More general. Just to mention the case that appeared in the spring literature. But essentially, so if you have a sphere, it's very simple what we have to do. On a sphere, there is always a solution of this equation. You take it, and you can define the supersymmetric Lagrangian with no extra vector. That's the Riemannian connection. I'm taking Riemannian geometry here.
So then it's obvious that we can't always find a solution for A.
In which case, this one? Yeah, because if you choose a spin that transforms only in the 1 of 0 representation of S4, the components of the spin connection acting on the spin leading in the other factor are 0. So there are these components, but they don't act on my equation. So I just need to look at the part of the spin connection that leads in S2. Again, I said in a bad way before. Acting on the spin or in the 1 of 0 representation only the C2 part of the spin connection. And this I can cancel with the C2 issue. Let me give you quickly another example. You can take, for example, and also this has been studied a lot in the literature, the case of product of this time, the sphere and the circle. Now, here again, you can check by yourself that if you take the spin that satisfies the Killing equation, the sphere, and you also turn on the component along the circle of the asymmetry, essentially this should be imaginary, and should have a constant part which is fixed by the equation, you can check that with this answer so you can solve this equation here. Now this case has been studied because it corresponds to something which is known as the superconformal index. And the total performance index is essentially the following. It's a partition function on ST times S1, and since there is an S1 factor, it can always be written as a trace of minus 1 to S, the fermionic number, times an exponential of essentially the anticommutator of the supercharge and the conformer supercharge plus some extra stuff that corresponds to fugacities for flavor signals. So this guy is a trace, so it counts the number of GTS states we sign of your conformers in here. And this can be realized as a partition function. Now, now that you have your specific Lagrangian, this is straight, so essentially you solve this equation. You couple gravity, you freeze the gravity multiplet, and you get a Lagrangian which is supersymmetric. You can apply localization. Okay, localization is a very old story. In case you go back again to the end of the 80s, there are again papers by Witten and other people. In mathematics, it's something well known. There are many concepts of localization in mathematics. They look different, but at the end, they always compute essentially integrals or traces of this form here by reducing an integral of a differential form to the fixed point of an action on the manifold. And in physics, it works in the following way. I'm being very schematic because, again, I need to specify all the indexes in the correct way, they should be specialization, type of spin-off, and so on. So this is very schematic. I want a supersymmetric theory with a fermionic generator that's square to zero, or more general, the two symmetry, atomic symmetry G of your Lagrangian. Then the idea is that you take your action, your Lagrangian, and you deform it in the following way. You add the transformation under the fermionic symmetry for the certain quantity that you are free to choose. You can also put an arbitrary parameter in front of it, thus getting a family of Lagrangian. Since Q square, Q one integrates S because the original theory is supersymmetric, Q square is a symmetry. If I choose the invariant under the symmetry G, Q of ST would be still zero. So I'm still writing a supersymmetric theory. And the idea is that even if I'm interested in the path integral for the original theory S, I can evaluate this family of path integral depending on D, on T, simply because the derivative with respect to T of this object is zero. The reason is the following. If you plug this object here, the derivative with respect to T of ZT will be down QT is the minus S. So essentially, you're assuming one expectation value of the transformation of some observable. If this transformation Q is a symmetry of your theory, this will be zero. Or you can also see the same. If you prefer the same argument in another way, since ST is invariant, it is the integral of Q of something. And if you write explicitly the typical fermionic transformation, you discover that the Q essentially acts on your path integral as a total derivative. So you might integrate your total derivative if you choose your V and S in a clever way such that at infinity you have no boundary terms, the integral of the total derivative is zero. So even if I introduce the parameter T, the partition function is invariant under T. So what I can do is the following. Evaluate this partition function for very large t. For very large t, I can use the saddle point. So the saddle point approximation tells me that I need to find the minima of this, this action and evaluate the action on the minima. And the other thing that remains to do with the saddle point approximation is to evaluate the determinant of fluctuation. And typically, this will be written as a determinant, a denominator of bosonic fluctuation, and the numerator, the determinant of the fermionic one, but if T is large enough, this will be an excellent result. So if you're lucky, and you need many things to work, if you're lucky, you can find a clever T, was arbitrary, such that this action is well-defined, positive, so bounded from below, and such that the classical solution, the minima of this action, are just few. In what sense? What happens typically is that when localization works, that most of the integration, say you have a particular integration over all the fields in the Lagrangian, essentially the saddle points reduce this computation to infinite number of saddle points, or if infinite, infinite dimensional subspace of configuration, so that this integral, and I'll show you an example after the break, becomes something simple. So typically it becomes the integration over few variables that are zero nodes typically of the field configuration, so this is a finite dimensional integral of some integrand which contains the classical action and the determinant for the fermion, which will depend on the variable u. So essentially what localization does for you is to eliminate the integral over the fields, and you will end with the matrix model essentially. If you are able to do that, well, this is model much better than the integral, and if you can explicitly evaluate the final integral here. So typically these guys in most cases live in the arcade variable, scalars for example, that live in the Cartan of your gauge group. So if you have, for example, a UN gauge group, and then you would use what this defense here, essentially it labels the eigenvalue of the UN matrix. So there are only n of them. This is a finite dimensional integral that you can look to them. Now let me just tell you maybe one thing and then we can talk about this break. This is a general argument. It's simple, obviously nothing is so simple in life. So when you try to apply it, there are so many subtleties. The first one is that when you go to the Euclidean, you need to perform